So, JSON Web Tokens. Tonight, we will cover basically how it works, why should we use it, and also a bit of some frequently asked questions that I received, and I'm really glad to answer on GitHub, but also here. Raphael already told, this is not working. So, this nice friendly guy, it's me. If you want to see everything I do on GitHub or LinkedIn or Facebook or Twitter, please use this nickname. I'm working with PHP since 2003. Yeah, and currently I work at Vertspot. But enough, you're here to hear about JSON Web Tokens. So the first thing I want to do is show you a token. Yeah! What is the first thing that comes to your mind? Come on, dude. Yeah, on my mind comes this. What the fuck? A base64 encode string? Come on. Is it real? Okay, wait. Let's understand. There's a dot there. Can you see? Those dots, base64 don't contain dots. Let's split it. Interesting. But usually, base64 strings contains a padding character, like an equal character. Do you remember that? Oh, nice. So this means that this is almost base64. This is called base64 URL. What's the difference? Is that we replace the characters there with this. And this makes everything URL safe. So this token can be passed as query strings, as path of the URL, and it will work, and nothing will break or translate it into, or encode it to some weird characters. But wait, this is something about JSON, right? There's no JSON here. Now that we know how to encode and decode that weird string, let's try to apply this algorithm. We will receive this. And probably your mind is like this. A lot of possibilities blowing your mind. I can store anything inside of a string. Interesting. Let's understand a bit more. The first part of a JSON Web Token, it's called headers. It contains basically the information about how we should handle this token. And the second part is the claims. What is that? Basically, everything you might want to. All data that can be encoded as JSON can be here, right? But why should I use that? I mean, tokens are usually, you use it basically as identification, right? So I receive a token to know what is the resource of it, and to say, okay, you are Pascal. Show me your token. You can pass. But sometimes we have some challenges, like Pascal, your ID cannot be used before tomorrow. So it's not valid today. Or it will expire on the day after tomorrow. Or maybe it can only be used in this room. How we solve these problems usually? We store it in a database, right? Like we have a big table with, okay, this is an identifier of the token or a hash or whatever, and it will expire on this date and can be used by this client and whatever. But it's quite messy, right? So we need a simple way to achieve that. And then we have this nice little guy called José. The Brazilians are laughing, obviously. This means JSON object signing encryption, and it contains some small parts. JSON web tokens, JSON web algorithms, JSON web signature, JSON web keys, and JSON web encryptions. Those are RFCs that basically maps how, says how you should use each thing. Which are algorithms you can use to sign or encrypt a content? How can you manage keys in a good way? And we will basically cover the first one with those two, JSON Web Token, algorithm, and signature. So let's get back to that example. We said that the claims can be anything, but we need like a standard to work properly, right? And the JSON Web Token RFC defines three categories of tokens, of claims. The registered ones, the private ones, and the public ones. What is the difference? This is, those are tokens, claims that are registered on IANA. You know what IANA means? Yeah. So we should never create, use the same claim that is registered there with a different meaning, because we need to avoid collisions. The same goes to the public ones, but the publics are not registered there. They are basically conventions of multiple issuers and just say, okay, for this thing, like the user, we all decided to use user claim. And the private ones are basically the ones that just the issuer and the client knows, and they agree on those terms, and they can, basically it's the interface between them. So different issuers may have different meanings for the same claims. The registered claims basically are those. And this shows a bit of the power of JSON Web Tokens. The first one, you can see that everything is like shortened. Why? The idea of a JSON Web Token is to have to be passed as a HTTP header or maybe a query string. And you know, if you have more characters on a string and you encode it using base 64, you will have a bigger string as output. So we need to avoid as much as possible this kind of thing without losing meaning. The first one is basically JSON token ID. It's a unique identifier of this token that you're going to create. Second is the issuer, is a string or a URI to say, okay, this token was issued by this server or this other server. The audience is, it can be just one string with a string or URI, or it can be multiple strings represented as a JSON array. Subject is what this token is about. Are we creating this token to, I don't know, to this is a user token or this is a password token, or this is related to the user ID one. You can basically, it's just a subject. Issued at expired, expire and not before. Those two solves with the audience solve those problems that we said before. To say, okay, this token is only allowed to be used for those clients, not before this date, and not after this date. Those are represented as basically integers, Unix timestamps, right? And the string claims, those are case sensitive. That means that if I use Luis or Cobucci as capital or lowercase, it will have different meanings. As we saw, a JSON Web Token is basically this construction. A base64 URL algorithm passing the headers with a dot as separator, the claims, and another dot. So again, this will be represented as this. Oh, but can we trust it? Is it a base64 secure? No, right? Anyone can just come here and say, okay, this is not user one, this is user two, and create a new content for it, and a new hash is born. So we need a new way to have that. Yeah. When you download a file, and some of the sites that you download things offers you a hash to validate if the content of the downloaded file is actually the same as the one that they have there in the server. So you can just run a hashing algorithm with the content of the file and see, oh, I have the same string or I have a different hash. And that means that the content was changed or partially downloaded, something got wrong. We apply the same thing here. Removing the last dot, we create a payload. And this payload is passed to a hashing algorithm with a key. What algorithm can be? RSA, ECDSA, AHMAC. It depends on the way you want to use it. But the important thing is the last part here that was missing before is a signature to ensure the integrity of this token. This signature is optional, but yeah, you wouldn't trust to create a token without a signature, right? Applying this thing here with a string as key. This means that we are using a symmetric encryption key. We'll talk about this later. We will achieve this. So, if someone changes one of those contents, we will have a different signature, right? And with that, we can ensure that if I am the only one that knows the encryption key, I can just do a check here and say, yeah, this token is invalid. It's not, you cannot use it here. How this whole concept can be used? I saw different use cases. The most common is to authenticate. Basically, when you have an API, because sometimes you get a random string as identifier for the user, and you generate something and communicate to say, okay, this user is this user, so you you're allowed to do that. With JSON Web Token, you can have this kind of thing, although it's not recommended to use a symmetric key and leave it exposed here, because if your client is a JavaScript client, everyone will be able to access that, but that's okay for now. Basically, the client will send the credentials to the server. The server will process that and generate the token, saying, okay, this user, the resource owner of this token is you, and you have this and this and this, and this token can be used until that date and just by this client. On the next request, the client will send that token, and the only thing the server needs to do is, okay, is the signature valid? Yeah. Is the token claims, are the token claims valid in terms of do we have an expired thing, or can we use this token if it is the date of no, the minimum date is lesser than now or greater than now? Let's check that. And basically, do the stuff that needs to be done. Since the we can store anything inside of the token, and how many of you have ever created a single page application? Sometimes you have a case like, okay, I authenticate this user, but I want to retrieve his information, like basic stuff, name and avatar. With that, we can store that information inside of the token, and we don't need to do an extra request to retrieve that, which is pretty good. But you, of course, you have always to think about what are you going to store in the token. This token will be passed on each request, right? Let's go a bit further. I love microservices, as I do love APIs. One way to use this and apply this on a microservice way is to have different services for different things. And here, we're using different keys also. This is called asymmetric keys. We have a key to create a hash and a key to validate it. I think you're pretty used to that, right? So the only service that knows the private key is the authentication service. It creates the token. The client can now use the token to different on different services. And here is a really good example on how to use the audience claim. Because this service knows the privileges of a user, so he basically can say, okay, the user A can only access the collection service. So the audience will be just collection or just the URL of the collection service. And when the user, the client tries to access the borrowing service with that token, this can say, okay, you cannot use this here. And you don't need to go to the database to do that. You just need to read the token. Okay, but doing this is a bit repetitive. Going to reading the token here, parsing it, and also validating the signature, which sometimes, depending on the algorithm you use, might be a bit expensive. Okay, let's do an API gateway. All the requests goes there. And this is also responsible of checking the token. And I can pass the information to here if I need or else I can just communicate there. Those services are just isolated and not exposed. Pretty simple, but also pretty powerful. One thing that is really important, the RFCs of JSON, of the whole concept, they don't mention on how you can use it or how you should use it. You can use your creativity and just figure another way to do that. You can also use the JSON Web Tokens with OAuth, because it's really you have the access token on the OAuth server. You can just use a JSON Web Token as the access token, and it will work. The PHP League package of the OAuth server has an implementation for that. So this covers authentication. What else can we use? Sometimes you have like an activation link on your email, and this link is only valid for 3 years or 3 days. 3 years is too much. or it can only be used on those conditions. You have like password recovering, I have a link that needs to authenticate the client in my application, but only use one of the resources that are available. For the other ones, I need them to log in and to do whatever they need. We can also do that because the tokens are URL safe, so you can just pass it as query strings. And you can read the token on the server side, on a PHP or Node.js thing, Python, or you can just get that token on the client side of JavaScript and just present information and validate things, and it will be really nice because it just works. Another thing is the sessions. This is really tricky because I saw some people saying, oh, we should not do that. We have other ways to, we shouldn't use JSON Web Tokens to replace the PHP session because it is just wrong. Okay, but let's play around and let's see the benefits of it. The PHP standard session library, it's a bit messy because it relies on a super global, right? And that's not so good because anyone can change it. If you don't plug in like any external driver, you will use a file storage, and files are complicated in terms of reading, I/O, you know. And also, if you have distributed servers, like you have a load balancer in the middle, you cannot guarantee that the session that was created on this server will be there also on the other server, because you rely on files, right? So you have to have a filing storage that is shared there, or use a caching mechanism to create the sessions. But what if we could just use the JSON Web Token? We all know how the session works. We have a cookie that has an identifier, and this identifier maps to a file or to an entry on a caching system, right? If we could replace that identifier with a JSON Web Token, we will have a self-contained session, and we will be able to store anything in that session and in that data. And the only effort we would have is just read the damn token and use it. Oh, if I change the content of the session, what do I have to do? Generate a new token. The client will store the cookie back and will send in a new request. So this whole file storage thing and problem is solved, and you don't have to rely on super globals. Of course, it depends on the how you implement that thing. But this is a way to use JSON Web Tokens. Okremius and I and Maluquinho, we played with this. There's a lib as a PSR middleware, PSR 7 middleware. So if you ever want to put in, yeah, not production, but try out, would be nice. Okay. Some questions that people frequently ask. Which algorithm should I use? Usually, you will see examples just using symmetric keys, like MAAC, SHA something, depending on the strength that you need. But what is the problem with that? We will have just one key to create the token and to validate the token. If we just lose this key or someone fetches it, they will be able to create tokens as you, and that is not good. I usually recommend people to use RSA because it's pretty easy. You just generate a private key and extract the public key from it, and it's done. If you really need to create shorter signatures, you could go with ECDSA. That is a different algorithm that also uses asymmetric keys and will produce shorter signatures when compared to RSA. Another really common question is how to block tokens. I mean, the user was, it doesn't matter the reason. I need to revoke the access of this token. Let's remember on the register claims. There is one claim that is the identifier of the token, the JSON token ID. We can just use that ID and store it on and create a blacklist with it. So you verify the signature, you validate the token, and check, okay, do I have this ID on the token blacklist? No, so you're safe to go. If I have, block the request and say, goodbye, my friend, I need a new token. It's not a hard thing to do, and even if you use like a caching system, which is also, yeah, I played around a bit and was really great because you can define the expiration date of the content of the caching thing. So I want to store my blacklist on Redis or Memcached. So the token 123, the expiration date that we have on the token is like 5 days or 5 hours. I will say that the expiration time of this blacklisted ID is 5 hours. What will happen? My check with the blacklist will be valid until this 5 hours, and after it, the token will not be valid anymore. So you don't need to bother on cleaning your blacklist because the caching engine will do this for you. What else is asked is, how much data can I use in that token? The short answer is always, it depends, right? Because how are you going to use this token? If you're just going to pass it as a header on an HTTP request or as query string, you will have limits. So you must ensure that this token will be shorter than your limit, right? But if you're planning to do a different usage of a JSON Web Token, like, I don't know, for some reason you want to use it as storage thing, So I will also have like a signature to verify if the contents are valid and everything. So you're storing this token in a way that you know. You will not need to bother on the size of the token and how much data. But it's really important to not put so much sensitive things inside of the token, because it's base 64 encoded, right? And that leads to another question. How to protect my data? Since it is base 64, anyone can read it. Here comes JSON Web encryption. And inside of the JSON Web token specification, we have a chapter that says about encrypted tokens and nested tokens. So we can create a new token with a different header that says what is the content type of this thing that is there, and which algorithm should be used to decrypt this content. And that's a really nice thing about a base 64, because you can use binary data and encode it, and you have a string that you can just use it, and it's binary safe. So an encrypted data usually is binary. If you do a base 64 or base 64 URL in code, you will have something that you can just pass to as a parameter of something or anything else. So I will leave some references for you guys. This is the specification. We have a blog on Red Hat. This site is really useful, because you will see other implementations, and you can also debug tokens. If you generate a token with a library, you can paste it there and see the content of it and play around and change the signature and see how it works. After you read everything and all the linked data that we have here, you can come to this lib and help me to improve it, because that's my PHP implementation of JSON Web Tokens. And this is the session middleware to use JSON Web Tokens as session cookies. Questions?
So basically, you have either portable tokens, right? And they're not safe. You can have them.
You mean in terms of what you can? Okay. It's not a replacement for sessions. It can also be used as a replacement for sessions. Okay. And basically, it's meant to be used as a self-contained identifier. So you can just pass it around and have the data inside of there. Usually, you should not have a lot of data in your session, regardless your storage engine, because, yeah, you need time to read that and to create the object or whatever. So it's not something that it's better than sessions. It can be used, okay? As I said, the commonly use of it is more like API authorization header. So you just use that instead of generating a random string and pass it as token and having to manage that by yourself in terms of, okay, this hash maps to this user. You have everything inside of this string, so you have a smart string, okay? And also this temporary files. This session has a lot of debates, so it's not, oh, it's better or it's safer. No, it's just another way. You will probably you will solve some problems that we have on the standard implementations of sessions, and you find more problems. So it's up to you to decide. Anything else? Sorry? Sorry, I didn't.
Concrete scenarios.
Google uses JSON Web Tokens to with OAuth. So if you open their console and their tokens, you will see that it is a base64 with dots, and you can grab this and see the content. Microsoft also uses it. Microsoft is part of the specification people, the ones that worked on that. And I heard that Spotify was also using it to identify their users. I use it on my APIs. Does this answer your question? More questions?
Is it safe to, for example, save a password in
a crypt? Let me reword your question. Would you pass your password around? And because it's base64 encoded. If you don't encrypt it, the data will be readable by anyone. Yeah. So, no. If you don't encrypt your token, it's not safe. So the only information you should store inside of a token is things that basically are things that can be anyone can read. If you do bother with security, you should encrypt your token. And then, of course, they will be secure, because only you will have the key to decrypt your token. Sorry? Yeah, well, HTTPS is quite of a requirement for anything that is exposed to the web, right?
And a follow-up question, are there implementations for example for a single sign-on?
I think they are. I actually don't know because all the experience I had with JSON Web Tokens was creating this library and reading the specification. So that's basically my intention. My goal here is to pass that knowledge to you. But I do know that there's a lot of dependencies of my library that plugs that to different things like Laravel frameworks and Symfony. And I also think that we have any specification with single sign-on. But as I said, you can use OAuth and use the access token as the JSON Web Token as the access token. And also, if you want, you can use it as a renew token. I don't know why you would do that, but you can. Yeah, because everything is there. You can put whatever is relevant for your services inside of the token.
The user token
No, you should never do that, yeah. Right? And the idea of this microservices thing, even if you have this API gateway, like that is responsible of validating the signature, you can just grab the token on your other services and use it to read whatever information you may like. You just don't need to validate it again, because that's the expensive task that you do, because creating hashes and validating hashes, it's, well, cryptography, right?
Yeah, but it's impossible to use it on single page application,
right? Why? Yeah. Okay, you have. But yeah, but you will not have the algorithm or the key to create a new token, right? And if you, as I said, if you really need to care about the data that you have there, you should not. You should encrypt your token, or you should not store things there. The idea is to have only things that are not so sensitive inside of a token that can be read by anyone, right? I saw people using roles to do that. I rather use have you ever heard about the third level of the Richardson maturity model? When we say about REST, right, an application, an API is only RESTful if it applies all the levels that we have on Richardson maturity model. And the last one is hypertext controls. So a resource will always give information about the linked resources. So instead of using the roles inside and storing it inside of the token, you should ask your server on which resources this user, this token can access. So the server, if you do a GET request on the root resource of your API, it will basically show some basic information about the API if you want, but the most important thing is the linked resources. Like, okay, this user can fetch the books of the library, can create, can schedule something, can borrow a book, but it cannot create a new book because the link is not there, or that's the way the server says that the client cannot do that. So having the role inside of the token will enforce you to create, to let your client know about permission system. And that is not so good. Anything else? Okay. Thank you, guys.